Welcome to Youthful Idiots.
Welcome to Youthful Idiots.
I'm Matt Taibbi.
I'm Katie Halper.
We're starting this week with a continuity error.
I like the way you're just owning that. Yes, welcome to Youthful Idiots is continuity error.
You're going to notice that we're not dressed the same in this segment as we are later in the segment because of a couple of things that happened.
Yeah.
Number one, we made a mistake. We had to actually excise.
Matt made a mistake.
I made a mistake.
We're keeping it in.
We're keeping it?
F it. We're doing it live.
Really?
F it. We're keeping it in. Yeah.
Fuck it. Let's do it live.
Yeah, let's do it live.
So isn't this weird? We taped, and it's a completely not terribly important story.
Right.
Like us, unless you're a member of the species.
Right.
We did a bit about Sri Lanka again, about a species of panther that was thought to be extinct, and then there was a picture taken of one,
right.
A black panther in Sri Lanka, and my isn't this weird this week was, hey, an extinct animal is no longer extinct.
Right.
And then the instant we did this, we taped it, it comes out that experts now believe it's not that panther. It's just a regular panther with a pigment mutation.
Wow. Isn't that fascinating, though?
Isn't that weird?
Isn't that weird? Okay, so we got another isn't that weird. It's
right.
A meta isn't that weird.
It's right,
isn't
yeah.
That weird it's weird about it's, an isn't
it's,
that weird.
It's turtles all the way down. But first of all, we have a great show.
Oh, yeah.
It's going to include an interview with Dennis Kucinich and some other stuff. But we should do an update because friend of show Glenn Greenwald, whom we interviewed last week, there's been a major development. Charges were filed, although it's been a little bit misreported. The federal prosecutors in Brazil have brought charges, but he's not yet indicted. They have an unusual system there where it's not official until a judge signs off on it. So that happened, and it was a big international story, and we talked to him, I talked to him on Wednesday. Do you want to say anything about this first?
I would like, you're the one who spoke to him, so tell us.
For people who don't know the story.
And you can find it now in Rolling Stone, right, by the time?
You can find it in Rolling Stone. I interviewed him yesterday, and it's actually already out. So
right.
For people who don't know the story, The Intercept Brazil did a series of exposés over the summer, in which essentially a hacker collective had been intercepting the phone calls of a bunch of Brazilian officials.
Right.
And they were digging underneath this thing called Operation Car Wash,
right.
Which was the...
Anti-corruption.
It was an anti-corruption probe.
Anti-corruption in quotes, yeah.
Yeah, the ultimate result of this, it was ostensibly a bribery case involving the former president, Lula.
Uh-huh.
And they intercepted all these phone calls and communications, which showed that the prosecution was kind of bent, right?
Yeah, very much,
and this led to Lula being invalidated as a candidate, and then... After that led to Jair Bolsonaro being elected.
Right.
The far
so just
right.
to clarify, so it was that, not that he was bent, it was their case against Lula that made him, disqualified him to run for office. He was also in jail. He was put in jail.
Right.
And then Bolsonaro, because of that, because all the polls were showing that Lula was doing really well, Bolsonaro basically became president, won the election because of that.
Right.
And then, thanks to this investigation by Glenn and The Intercept, they saw that the prosecution had been kind of in bed with the judge, right? Was it the
yes?
Yeah.
And that's the most substantive things they got were these communications between the judge, Sergio Romo. Moro.
Romo's
the former closer for the Tampa Bay Rays.
Okay, yeah, Moro.
Moro. And basically what they showed is that the judge was kibitzing with the prosecution, helping them, giving them advance notice of rulings.
Right.
So anyway, that happened. Big, major expose. And they did great work in doing it. They were very careful legally.
Yeah.
Because it's complicated, this is stolen material,
sure.
So you have to. So the government, even though they did an investigation last year and concluded that there was no evidence of a crime, they kind of turned around, and Glenn was charged ostensibly with being part of an ongoing criminal scheme. So he's charged with like all 126 felonies or whatever it is. You know, it's a serious thing.
Yeah.
I mean, he could end up, he's not incarcerated now. I talked to him Wednesday. He was taking a walk on a farm. He's fine now. But from the moment it goes before a judge, if a judge doesn't throw it out, which is possible, he's at risk of being incarcerated.
Yeah.
There's a lot of angles to this that are really unpleasant.
Yeah.
So people know what the issue is. What they're saying is that when Glenn talked to the source who came to them, who had already gotten all the material before they contacted Glenn or The Intercept, so that you can't claim that they were part of any
scheme
to steal.
Right, it wasn't on behalf of the... Right, yeah.
Right, it was already done by that point. But they talked, and the person asked for advice. You know, should I destroy X files? Should I maintain a record of my right. communications with you? Blah, blah, blah. And Glenn, being very careful, said, you know, I can't advise you one way or the other. Like, it would be inappropriate for me to advise you. And they took that. They took that non-act and turned it into an implicit exaggeration or implicit encouragement to criminal conspiracy.
Okay. So because he didn't say no. He didn't say erase those things, give them back?
Yeah, I don't know what they would have wanted him to say. And there's that, plus the fact that during the time period they were communicating, these hackers were trying to penetrate other targets that irrelevant to this story. So that's the argument. But the problem is, and you know, legally it's a very thin read, but, you know, as Glenn said when I talked to him, does the law even matter in this country, right? So that's not really the issue.
Right. And they really dislike Glenn Greenwald. The president hates him. He exposed all their, because then the issue with the Intercept investigation is that prosecutor, was it the prosecutor or the judge who became like the highest?
The judge who became like the supreme justice official.
Okay, the judge became a supreme justice official. Mm-hmm. So he exposed that. Also, as a result of the investigation, Lula was freed.
Right.
Basically. So the president, who is incarcerated, is now out of jail,
right,
which is great. And in case people missed this for whatever reason, because you shouldn't have, because you're addicted to useful idiots, but on the last episode, we did talk to Glenn about this, and he summarized it.
And, you know, the other thing scary. I think that people are going to be curious about, and I asked him about this, why not just leave?
Yeah, right? I kept wanting to ask him about that. That was before this. I just meant for his own safety and his family's safety.
Yeah, I mean, you know, if you didn't catch it in the interview that we did with him, he hasn't been outside of his home without armed guards since like June.
Yeah.
You know, every aspect of his life has been impacted. His two kids have been very impacted by this.
Right.
You know, his husband David Miranda has been very impacted by this. And you know, for me, cowardice in this situation would be a virtue. Like, you know, I would be packing my family up and leaving at the first hint of it, you know.
Yeah.
But he doesn't feel that way. He's got a bit of an unusual take on it. He loves Brazil. He's been there for 15 years. He's, you know, it's his adopted country.
Right.
And he has been, I think, in some ways even more aggressive in opposing Bolsonaro than he might have been at home. In a way, I think he sees it as he was showing people that you don't have to be afraid.
Right.
They have this kind of
they're an
tradition
out-gay couple
of being,
who's married that has two kids. Also, we talked about that last time. Like, he's pushing back against the idea that you can't be a happy out-gay couple, and they're a public gay couple, and they have sons, and they're a happy family, and
Exactly. So I think he feels that it would be a huge betrayal if he were to leave at this point. What he said was, you know, I can't just flee and leave it to people who have, you know, less resources than
I
do.
He does have a high profile and some access, right, that others don't.
So he's committed to kind of sticking this out no matter what happens. He also, I think, you know, another angle that I think people don't think about is, okay, let's say he came home. You know, he said theoretically he could be extradited back. The United States government doesn't love him.
Right, yeah.
You know, it's not clear where he'd be able to go. Russia, right? You think?
Yeah, Russia, yeah.
Hang out in with Snowden and Zagorsk or wherever he lived. So, you know, that's an interesting question.
Could he leave now, though? When you're allowed to leave when you're...
Well, you can always break the law and leave. I mean, he's not in custody right now.
Would he be fleeing?
He would be, yeah. Okay. Yeah. But he has no intention of doing that. Doesn't sound like. And he sounds kind of like comfortable with his decision. It's crazy.
It is true that having a higher profile person with access and reach and connections does in a way have like a residual effect on the rest of the society, because if he's exposing this stuff in a way that he wouldn't be not living there, I mean, he would be, I'm sure, if he did leave, he'd be writing about it, talking about it. But it does kind of like keep a focus on them.
Yes, absolutely. It adds gravitas to the reporting, too. But, you know, I don't know. I mean, he says it's not just about the journalism for me. You know, it's my country. It's my life. It's my family. I have Brazilian kids. I have a Brazilian husband.
Right.
So
Who's a congressman?
He's an elected member of Congress. Yeah.
Who replaced another person who was LGBTQ, also, who fled out of fear for his own life.
Right. And another thing I thought was interesting that he talked about There are some people who are trying to draw a distinction between this case and the Assange case.
Yeah.
Like, there are some press critics who are saying, oh, well, Assange actually did help Chelsea Manning, you know, try to hack and obtain those files from the Army. But Glenn is innocent, so this is a different kind of press freedom case. Glenn, on Wednesday, totally quashed that. He's like, this is exactly this is similar. His position has always been that Assange was merely helping Manning protect her identity and evade detection, which is something reporters do all the time.
Right.
Like, if you know, if somebody calls you and you say, for instance, maybe we shouldn't talk on an open line.
Right.
Maybe we should meet somewhere else.
Safety. You know, just advising safety, right?
You be careful when you talk to your coworkers. Like, that's kind of in the same. So he takes that position, and then he took a step further, and he said he thinks that because Bolsonaro and Trump are buddy-buddy, that Bolsonaro might have actually gotten some inspiration to make this move from seeing their indictment of Assange.
Right.
He's saying, well, if they can make such a thin case against Assange, why can't I do the same thing here? And so just for people who might think that there's a distinction there,
Glenn is saying there isn't.
Yeah, it's exactly the same problem that's been a problem for a while, which is that the governments are more worried than ever about secrets.
Yeah.
So they are expanding the definition, A, of what's classified, and then they're also trying to expand the definition of what theft is by saying that, you know, advising a source is part of the conspiracy to steal, and so we're gonna rope you into that, and that makes everybody not want to do the reporting, and this is a classic example of that. Right?
Isn't Glenn's source a whistleblower?
Well, okay, so not really.
Why not?
I mean, I guess you could argue, like, one argument, which is one that John Kiriakou made with us, is that illegalities cannot be secret legally.
Right.
Right, that's a principle in America. Like, you can't classify something that's breaking the law. So if you're bringing something forward,
you're shining a light on something, right?
Then you're shining a light on it. But, you know, these guys weren't like workers in the Justice Ministry.
Sure,
they're not like internal people coming forward with.
Right.
You know, they got it through other means. So.
Oh, so that just changes it. So to be a whistleblower, you have to like be within that institution and bringing it out.
I think typically that's the definition. Yeah.
But it doesn't make it any more. You could argue it's equally moral, right?
Well, from a reporting point of view, it's not really different.
Right.
I mean, the issue is, you know, the courts in this country have upheld that it's legal to publish material that was obtained through theft. There was a case involving some people who stole, you know, transmissions, like phone calls.
Right.
Bartnicki v. Vopper is the Supreme Court case. Says that you can journalists are allowed to publish things that are stolen. That's in America. So that's a principle.
Right.
It's kind of, you know, people publish things that are stolen all the time. And in this case, it's a little different because, you know, they weren't working within the institution, but it's still relevant.
Yeah,
so.
Right. It's still theft in order to expose an illegality.
Yeah. I mean, you wouldn't.
Sorry.
Well,
I wanted to pretend
me.
I was like in a court, like a judge or a.
Anyway, so that happens. We'll talk to him again as we get closer to.
Yes,
then the next thing is when they go before a judge. But for now, he's
really
okay.
Scary.
But you know, I think it's it's another major kind of press freedom case. And,
yeah. So I wonder if there's anything. I was trying to see if there's anything online people can do to support Glenn Greenwald. But
I mean, they're good.
There are going to be
petitions. Yeah. All the relevant press freedom organizations are already rallying behind them.
We'll use this is not, it sounds like I'm being, we'll use Useful Idiots Pod hashtag to link to anything that comes up that
absolutely.
You can do for Glenn.
One last funny note about this. If you read Glenn's Twitter feed, he was trashing the New York Times editorial page as recently as Monday or Tuesday because of their endorsement of Warren and Klobuchar and some other things.
Yeah.
But then they came out with a very strong editorial in support of him.
Yeah.
And so he was laughing about this, and he turned it right around and said, look, great New York Times. What an amazing editorial page they have.
Anyway, so that's our update. We got a Panther update, and we got a Glenn update. And one's more serious than the other.
And again, we'll give you, we'll be talking to him throughout this process. So we'll keep you informed.
Yeah.
We have a great show.
We're
going to be talking to
The Coos is loose.
The Coos, Congressman Dennis Kucinich, who ran for president in 2004, 2008, super interesting guy, yeah. Incredible, bizarre background, survived 3 assassination attempts, talks about all kinds of interesting stuff.
Yeah.
And then we have an amazing, another crazy week in American politics that we're going to be talking about.
And the craziest thing of all, the most important development, is that we are going to soon be providing you guys with
merch. In fact, we have we have Useful Idiots merchandise that's going to be coming up. But we want to actually appeal to the audience and ask you what you think the best and most ridiculous merch line that we should develop would be.
The most useful idiot line. Useful idiots line, yeah.
Right. I mean, we're going to do probably the obvious, you know, mugs, hats, that sort of thing. But, you know, something a little weirder, you know, and aprons, onesies.
Oh, we need aprons. Definitely need onesies so that people can have their kids and useful idiots.
But even more ridiculous than that. Like, we want you to, you know, tweet us with something. You have something very bizarre. You want to know about it.
This wouldn't be bizarre, but it'd be good to have, what are the things that you, coasters?
Coasters, right. Coasters, yeah.
Flasks for the drinking games if we do
right. I'm thinking something more like, you know, like a radar-guided anti-aircraft missile.
Yeah, that
or something
too.
That
was going to be next on my list, right along with the equally ambitious, like, temporary tattoos.
Those are good.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like those a lot. Yeah. Actually, that would be kind of interesting.
It would be, right?
Yeah. All right. Four food groups?
Yeah, four food groups. Let's
only go. Four news stories in the world. Republicans suck. Democrats suck. Isn't that weird? Isn't that terrible? Should we start with Democrats suck this week?
Yeah.
We got a good one that literally just happened. There is a news story. Hulu is coming out with a documentary called Hillary. And Hillary Clinton... I should just step back. I personally don't want Useful Idiots as a show to be so Bernie-centric. It's not something that I personally would like, but the news is just moving us in this direction. Well, every week there's something crazier and crazier. And Hillary, now in this interview, they're giving little previews of what she's saying. And you know, the headline is, nobody likes him. She's talking about Bernie. Nobody likes him. Nobody wants to work with him. He doesn't get anything done. And the one that was the most amazing is, he's a career politician.
I mean...
Are you kidding me?
Yeah. The projection is real. Like, the projection is so real. Nobody likes
Freud
him.
No,
I know. We should... I mean, I tweeted about some of these things today. I was like... Nobody likes him. And then I put these photos of her rallies and his rallies side by side. And it's just like, you can't make it up.
Right.
Like, you might as well be like, he's married to a politician who has been, a former president who has been accused of sexual assault by many people.
He was a morally ambiguous corporate lawyer.
Yeah,
exactly. Right. I mean, like, are you...
Like, really? Yeah.
Part of me almost thinks that Hillary Clinton is way more astute about the media than we give her credit for. And she's playing the villain card as some kind of marketing strategy.
Yeah, well, you said when she was on Howard Stern, you said like you almost respected her because it was like
punk.
Yeah,
I was starting to enjoy it. Yeah, she's throwing it in everybody's face. But now I'm almost thinking that it's a level beyond that, that she's trolling like in a almost like a Trumpian fashion.
Yeah,
don't you think?
Maybe.
There's no other thing that would explain it. You know, she's being so
vindictive.
She's a politician and she knows what you can and cannot say.
Right.
And she's just stomping on that with reckless abandon in a way that's almost kind of entertaining.
Do you think she's pulling out, she's showing us how wretched she is so that people will be less disgusted by the other Dems besides Bernie?
That's interesting.
I think I'm probably thinking of that from my perspective too much, though, because I don't think I'm her demographic that she's trying to reach out to.
Well, that's sort of the reverse psychology strategy. Remember when, you would remember this. So when George H.W. Bush nominated Dan Quayle.
Yeah. Potato speller.
Yeah, but who couldn't spell potato. And a lot of people thought, okay, he picked somebody who's so dumb that it makes Bush look not so bad.
Right.
And I think there might have been something to actually. Right?
Yeah, I mean, if I were anyone besides Bernie, I'd be like, Hillary, can you get out there again so people can have like a lower... Yeah.
Yeah, no,
Biden,
I'd vote for him 8 times.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, right?
I'm going to go volunteer. I'm going to do 22 reasons or whatever day we're on. 20 reasons, 17 reasons, Joe Biden. I'm going to make... We should do one of those where we go back and forth for him, by the way.
You think?
We should do one for Hillary.
That's
why
not
should
a bad
go
idea.
Away. I guess she should stay out. I don't know. It makes me, as a Bernie person, it's just like, wow, more opportunities to remind people of what an ungrateful... And there's nothing misogynist or sexist about this. And this, as a feminist, I just want to say something. There are many, I'm not saying how many genders there are, but traditionally, most of almost all politicians fall into one of two genders, right? And historically. And politicians are calculating people. That means that sometimes women who are politicians are going to be calculating. And I'm not going to pretend that someone, because she's a woman, is not calculating. So, especially when she's so incredibly calculating.
Right.
But I feel like people really weaponize this stuff. Like, you can't say someone's calculating because she's a woman. It's like, no, she's a politician. She's going to be calculating. And she happens to be a woman. And it's actually sexist to pretend a woman can't be calculating.
That's true. That's true.
So if you're a feminist, call Hillary Clinton.
Calculating?
Calculating.
Huh.
I mean, that's me being diplomatic.
That's your... That's
I never use, like...
Yeah, I'd like to peer into what your actual thoughts are.
I don't use problematic words. I just use more, like, sociopath. I mean, if I were not being as diplomatic, I would say sociopathic. Remember Abby Martin was on, and we read what she had said about Tulsi Gabbard? Mm-hmm. And Abby just, like, very seriously, not joking, she's like, it's just a narcissistic personality disorder. Very seriously said it, which made me laugh really hard.
The only problem with that is that's a blanket diagnosis that you could give to basically anybody who's ever run for president.
It's true, right. And also, we don't want to get... Right, and this is weirder. It's not just that. And I also don't want to give her an excuse. Like, I'm not going to diagnose her. Also, I have no way to do that. I'm not a doctor or a psychologist. Right. But also, I don't want people to think that she has no choice. And I'm not pathologizing her. I'm trying to vilify her, not pathologize her. And I want to make that very clear.
I'm not pathologizing her because I want to encourage it. I think it's incredibly entertaining.
I'm a fangirl. She's former hater, current
fangirl. She's got to do more. Like, I think she should come out, like, with, you know, in a gigantic sort of leather costume with skulls on it and stuff like that.
Just Bernie's completely with Bernie skulls.
Yeah,
with skulls,
exactly.
With the white hair coming around it.
Yeah, it would just be fantastic. Like, she's on the verge of becoming that kind of character. She's like the
Worst.
Yeah, it's
she's
it's
the
awesome.
Worst. She's the best. The worst. You know, and this is something that happens all the time. It's like every time I think that Hillary can never do something like this again, that she's already been as terrible to Bernie Sanders as she's going to be.
She
was it from Dumb and Dumber. You go ahead and do something like this and totally redeem yourself.
So, right.
So I made this when Hillary's What Happened book came out, which is, as Jimmy Dore says, what happened? The answer is the author's name. So, and I made this, and it's as applicable then as it is now, or now as it was then. So, yeah.
I watched Senator Sanders defending himself from your book, and I'm wondering, why did you reopen a wound in your own party?
I don't agree with that. I wanted to tell what happened. I won a landslide victory. I know what it's like to win, and I know what it's like to lose. And when I lost to Barack Obama, I immediately turned around. I endorsed him.
You don't buy the party unity argument.
I don't. You know, my husband did not wrap up the nomination in 1992 until he won the California primary in the middle of June.
I convinced my supporters to vote for him.
We all remember Bobby Kennedy was assassinated in June.
I didn't get the same respect
favorite Hillary
from
moment.
My primary opponent.
I move that the convention suspend the procedural rules, and I move that Hillary Clinton be selected as the nominee.
Senator Sanders has moved in the spirit of unity.
I congratulate her. I intend to do everything I can to make certain she will be the next president.
That's just an abbreviated version of it. It's just the hypocrisy, the entitlement, the delusional, everything.
My favorite thing is the refrain about how he didn't support me earlier, early enough. I guess it's because people have a short cultural memory and they don't remember how bitterly contested 2008 was.
Right.
I mean, that was, nobody gave an inch in that campaign until Obama was formally made the nominee.
Right.
It was you know, in the balance until basically that moment. And it was, there was no love lost between those campaigns at all. And it was, I just, the revisionist history is absurd.
Yeah.
And you know, interestingly, she's asked about whether or not she would theoretically endorse Sanders candidacy, and you know, she gave this noncommittal answer, like, we're not there yet. It's, you know, like,
so the answer is no. So she's the, like, Trump enabling purity politics person that all her defenders accuse.
And as she should be pointed out, that's an easy question to answer, right? Like, the question is, if you're in a race, you're not going to answer that question,
right?
Because you say, what are you talking about? I'm going to be the nominee. Like, that's how you answer that question. But if you're not in it, it's the easiest thing in the world is to say, well, you know, I'm a Democrat. I'll vote for whoever the Democrat is, you know. And
which is better? Okay, better or worse? The Warren treatment of Sanders? Because I have to admit, I kind of, there's something badass and like straightforward about how terrible she is to Bernie
as Hillary.
Hillary,
totally.
As opposed to the, like, Well, Bernie called me a liar and he's sexist, but let's move on from that.
Oh, yeah. No, that was good.
Thank you. Yeah.
That was good. You got the note just right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, and the head turn. Yeah.
Yeah. We didn't even get to talk about this last week and it was painful because you wrote this really good piece. I mean, it was painful. It was like emotional blue balls watching that debate and not being able to process it with you. But it just kept getting worse and worse. And when
I couldn't believe the moment. And I heard about this from some other people, who covered the debate.
Yeah.
That when Abby Phillip did that whole thing where she asked,
she
asked Sanders to say, just to be clear, you didn't say that.
Right.
And he's like, no.
No.
Right. And then she moves to Warren and says, when he said that.
What did you think when he said that?
Yeah. So apparently there were gasps in the press room.
Yeah.
And I'm not surprised. That was a kind of a stunning thing. It just took the mask off the whole
network. Oh, my God. It was awful.
And the amazing thing is the network must know how that plays not just to its Democratic audience, but to everybody.
Right.
Right? Because it's going to reinforce every fake news cliche.
Yeah.
I don't know. Yeah. It was crazy.
It was crazy. And then the handshake thing?
Oh, yeah, that whole thing, that seemed, if you're asking the question, well, what's worse, like, that felt really staged to
me. Right?
I don't know, guess we can't say that because we don't know.
I got tricked because, as we've covered in the show, she has a thin skin and gets very frazzled, so we saw her, remember when Amy Goodman asked her a normal question, she lost it and was like, yeah, like, when she's like, thank you, she's like, yeah, and then that other clip that you showed where she's like, don't, that face, like,
right,
she kind of loses
.
It, so I thought, oh, she just lost it, but then I was like, no, she had a time to go up to him, and as everyone probably knows, because they released the audio, she was like, I think you just called me a liar on television.
Well, right, I mean, you know that you're being, there's no such thing
lip
as off,
either, right,
you know,
or people
off
can read
mic
lips, yeah,
and a stage. I mean, everybody knows that, and that's like, that's politics 101, is if you don't intend for everybody
right
in the world to know it, don't say it.
Yeah,
you know?
So she wouldn't shake his hand,
right,
and then goes, I think you just lied about me on national television. And
right,
he's like, look, you want to talk? Look, let's talk about later. She's like, anytime, like soccer mom, like fights back or something. I don't even know what it was. It was so nerdy and so pseudo badass.
I don't mean that.
And then he's like, you lied about me. All right, we'll talk about it later. And then he leaves.
That's good.
And then thank you. And he's such a mensch that, like, the first person who asked him what they had said
Steyer
on the record, I forget who it was. They were like, what'd you talk about? And when you were, when you guys didn't shake hands, and Bernie Sanders was like, the weather, which is like, anyone who doubts he's Jewish, evidence, peace, number, whatever. It's like such a menschy thing. But I was so, I mean, obviously I like him, but like, I was so disgusted by that.
Yeah.
Like, how dare you?
Right. I don't know. I suspect that, someday, years from now, we're going to find out about all sorts of machinations that took place behind the scenes
right
with the Democratic Party. You know, there's just too much weirdness going on with this.
And you've seen the Believe Women thing, right?
Oh,
which
yeah,
is a whole other episode.
Yeah,
but just very short PSA, the term Believe Women and Me Too is not intended to describe non-sexual political discussions between two equally powerful people.
Right.
So you can just stop doing that. It's actually
right
really offensive and belittling. Anyway, so
moving on. Republicans
moving on.
Suck. What do we got?
Republicans suck. We got this guy, Rick Wilson,
mm-hmm,
one of my faves, who just no holds bars in the way he treats. Again, I like Sanders. We don't mean to talk about him all the time, but like, these attacks on him are just so egregious, and we got to address them. So here's Rick Wilson, Republican, part of the online Never Trump resistance, who's on Brian Williams.
Bernie is every cliche the Republicans want to run against. He's a Northeastern liberal. He's 375 years old. He just had a heart attack. He doesn't scan as a president. He scans as a associate professor of poetry at Bennington Community College. He does not come across as
Bennington
the guy you want to have in charge of 7,000 nuclear weapons.
Okay, clearly he doesn't know his Vermont colleges. Bernie is not a Bennington professor,
yeah,
but Bennington professors are for
WASPy,
the ultra wealthy WASPy.
Yeah, yeah, he's a CUNY professor.
Bernie's a CUNY professor.
Yeah, thanks,
like,
Rick.
I get the professorial thing.
Yeah,
but
I know you're so dumb.
Yeah.
But I want to give him a shout out because the guy, you can hear his apnea in the way he speaks, Rick Wilson, and I want to give him a shout out for owning that and still feeling comfortable calling Bernie Sanders old.
Right.
I guarantee you Bernie Sanders could literally run laps around him and beat him at a game of basketball.
I should cop to the fact that if I'm not mistaken, we should fact check this, but Wilson actually said one of the funniest things in 2016. He said that Trump supporters were all childless single males who masturbate to anime.
Oh, I think he did say something like that.
Which is funny, actually.
That. He also asked Ann Coulter on Twitter if she charges more for anal, if Trump charges more for anal.
Oh my goodness, that's again, I don't want to make this show all about Bernie, but the MSNBC.
Let's make it about how ridiculous it is that this guy is a Republican, he's on all the time, and how cloying it was to hear Brian Williams say, "You're a patriot."
I know, yeah, exactly. You're can you tell me about how much of a patriot you are?
And he's like, "Look, I mean, I'm as unsentimental as I am, I'm a patriot."
You know, Brian, as I think I've demonstrated over the last couple of years, my political preferences and my ideological predicates don't matter in the face of a guy who could destroy our country and is rapidly working to do so.
Because you're a patriot.
I am. You know what? As unsentimental as I am, I'm a patriot first.
But look, it's
so gross.
It's not like it's breaking character. Like, you know, this guy, Bill Kristol, David Frum, these are the heroes of the party now.
Yeah, I know.
So I don't know. Whatever. David
Frum is at least, like, I really don't like him, but he seems intelligent. This guy just seems, and it's like a weird
Frum is
love.
Smart. Like, he's
yeah, he
some,
is.
He's,
that's
he's
what I'm saying.
Some,
this guy, Rick Wilson, is like,
I don't agree
he's the
with
Brian
him,
Williams.
But,
of
yeah.
They should have a show together called, like, Really Dumb. And then I love that Brian Williams, I don't know if you noticed this, he puts on his glasses to try to look smart, and he calls Messina Donald Trump's 2012 campaign
right,
manager.
Yes. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like Freudian slip, because remember Messina rejoiced when Donald Trump won?
Oh, right. Yes, the Pied Piper thing?
Yeah.
Interesting. Right. Isn't that weird? I just had to go back to Sri Lanka.
You got to go. You're a nationalist. You're becoming a...
And I felt like I slandered Sri Lanka a little bit last week because I said that the person, whoever that was who was smuggling the scorpions, was probably had probably met to an untimely end. I don't know that. So the story here is an extinct animal is no longer extinct.
That's wonderful.
There is a black leopard, the Sri Lankan black leopard, which was presumed to have no longer existed, to the point where the corpses of three black leopards had been posed in a museum in Sri Lanka as these are the last ones that we found. But they had one of those cameras that's set up so that it takes pictures when something walks by.
Yeah.
And it took a picture of the leopard, and so
and
it exists.
Back.
Right?
Can you read the headline, by the way? I think I want to make people hear it.
Sri Lankan black leopard not extinct, / spotted again.
Spotted.
Yeah.
Oh, come on.
It does have spots underneath the black, right?
Oh, weird.
Anyway, good news, right? So
it's great news.
It's like the coelacanth story, right? Remember they thought that was a prehistoric fish, no longer exists.
No.
The guy goes fishing, catches it. It's awesome.
Well, these things are looking good because a tortoise just gave birth to not gave birth to what? Did you see this? A tortoise fathered 80,000 turtles. I'm not making it up. Can someone look for this?
Look at that face.
Could you say no? How could anyone resist him?
This Playboy tortoise had so much sex, he saved his entire species. Now he's going home.
Well, he's like, he's like 100
headline.
Yeah, I know. You know, he has a lot of age in that neck, that tortoise.
That's an excellent neck. That's a Biden neck.
Oh my God, it is a Biden neck.
Yeah.
I wonder if he says really problematic things about other tortoises and the way they look. Like, listen, fat. listen, slowpoke.
Listen, slow.
Yeah.
All right, what do we have for terrible?
So it's terrible. We have a story. It happens to the worst of us. It happens to the best of us. Man suffers 3-day erection after taking sexual stimulant used to breed balls. So this is a case that happened in, I think he was from Mexico. He traveled to Veracruz in Mexico, in East Mexico, to buy this stimulant. And you know these articles that don't have a lot of information? This was in the Daily Mirror. So they emphasize these weird things, like in order to have sex with a 30-year-old woman. Like, what's his, they
how
just
old
have
is
to,
he?
I don't know. We don't know how old he is, but clearly somehow they know her age and not his age or something. So they're just trying to jam pack it with them. So yeah, a man had to be rushed to the hospital after taking a stimulant used for breeding bulls that left him with 3-day erection. The man in Mexico, whose name is unknown, is believed to have taken the stimulant as he excitedly planned to have sex with a 30-year-old woman. However, he ended up needing surgery to tackle the persistent engorgement at Specialist Hospital.
Specialist Hospital 270, which in Reynosa City on the U.S.-Mexico border, La Republica reports.
Yeah, and Dr. told the newspaper he had taken a sexual stimulant, which he had bought in Veracruz, used by farmers in that region to invigorate bulls for insemination.
This is the guy.
Yeah. This has happened before, but not from this. There was just another case of a guy with a long-lasting erection who had to have surgery on it.
It sounds like a Darwin Award story. Right? I mean,
yes.
the only thing that didn't happen is that the guy didn't, his entire body didn't explode. Yeah,
right,
exactly.
Yeah.
Like, you know, it would have.
You know, you said that you're the Rodman of
I was the Mongolian Rodman.
Do you know
yes.
he had a couple of penis breaks?
No.
Yeah, apparently he's like broken his penis 3 times, Dennis Rodman.
He's broken his penis. I didn't even know you could really do that.
Well, I guess you're not really the Mongolian Rodman.
I guess not. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Lucky
no, that's terrible.
You.
That's
yeah.
terrible. I don't know what I can say about that story that would be appropriate.
Hard to top that.
Hard.
Just the top. Just the tip. Sorry.
all right. So.
All right. Cool. What should we go next? We got so much to talk about. We got the Times endorsement.
We do. I guess we should we start with the New York Times endorsement?
Yeah.
So, the New York Times did something that was. That was, I would say, unprecedented and bizarre.
Mm-hmm.
They did this whole process, like this made-for-TV process, to discuss how they were going to arrive at the decision of whom to endorse in the Democratic primary. And they did these elaborate interviews. They were filmed. And then they finally do the endorsement. And it's a 3,500, 4,000-word article where they don't make a decision. They chose.
Oh, right.
They decided to endorse both Amy Klobuchar and Elizabeth Warren. And the logic was just incredibly convoluted. So basically, what they say is, and this is interesting because it's the first time it's really been, I think, expressed in major news media. They say accurately that there are really three big choices in American politics now. There's kind of the Trumpian vision. There's the progressive sort of transformative vision articulated by Sanders. And then there's the traditionalist approach. And what they say is, okay, there are three visions. We're going to not choose between two of them. And of the two that we're going to choose, we're going to only pick the two that are best argued in our opinion. And that's how they arrive at this right. crazy decision between Warren and Klobuchar, which just, it was nuts. I don't know what to say.
Well, it's really a bad thing for Warren, I think, for a couple of reasons.
Mm-hmm.
One is, like, she does try to play it like she's a progressive. And this is kind of like, you're with, like, the woman who, besides abusing her staff, which we joke about a lot, but it's actually quite serious. Like, mm-hmm. she does throw staplers at her staff. And the New York Times itself reported on it. And they had, like, some throwaway line where they kind of acknowledged that, but it's not that big of a deal.
Right.
You'd think it would be kind of a big deal. I mean, you'd think they go with one of the candidates who does not have a documented history of throwing objects at their subordinates. But it's pretty bad for Warren because Klobuchar is such a kind of an avowed centrist, like that's almost her thing. That's what she runs on. And so being in the same camp with her, for Warren, who pretends to be this person who's like, you know, Bernie like
transformative, yeah.
Yeah, is not very good. Also, I think it's a little offensive, like, what is the tie that binds? They're both women? Like, is this just some weird...
Well, they weren't trying to say that there was a tie that binds, though.
But why is this... No, I know, but, like, why those two? Because they're both... What do they have in common? I mean, I read it, but it didn't make sense. And their characterization of Sanders was, of course, really stupid. And they did that whole, like, swapping in one extremism for another, which, again, you're just telling us that, like, Sanders could actually defeat Trump.
So just as background on this whole process that the Times did. So they... Not only is this, they ended up doing a special podcast, and I think at some point we should listen to it, because they did a whole regal rollout of how they arrived at the sacred process of the endorsement. But even better than that, look, they have this caption on at the heads of each of the interview stories, and this is what it says. The editorial board is a group of opinion journalists whose views are informed by expertise, research, debate, and certain long-standing values. Just the pomposity of that is awesome. Can you say to me, I have certain long-standing values?
I have certain long-standing values.
I mean, how do you not feel ridiculous
attaching yourself to that? Well, it's the pseudo-humility also of it, right? Like, I have certain long-standing values.
Right.
Like, I'm not a saint, but I have certain... Like, I'd rather they actually just said an upstanding values. Yeah, what is this measure? Yeah.
It's just then they asked these completely crazy. This was the one where they asked Sanders, like, how can people feel secure that you're not going to be Trump if you are flying around on airplanes and addressing large crowds? But whatever. The point is they are celebrating the extreme awesomeness, right, and weight of this process, and then they just completely punt on it in the end, which is just hilarious. It's hilarious that Nate Silver called this, by the way. Did you see it?
Oh no! Wow, good Nate, good on Nate.
He put out odds about whom the Times would endorse, and the best odds were for Warren, but at 10-1. He said they endorse no one or two candidates or something dumb like that.
Oh, nice.
Which is pretty. I mean, I'm not a fan of Nate's work late, but that was a pretty good call. That gave some insight into.
Right. I wonder what Warren thought of it.
Well, yeah. Well, how do you feel about it if you're one of these candidates? I mean.
Warren refund. Hashtag Warren refund. Remember, she should ask for her.
Right.
Money back, not that she paid, but
I flew all the way to New York, and all I got was half of this lousy endorsement.
Yeah, exactly.
There's so much in this piece. The only thing they say about Yang is we hope that he gets involved with New York politics. Like, you know, he did all right. You know, he demonstrated some appeal and whatever, and he's got some interesting ideas. We hope he gets involved in New York politics. Like, it's he's not so already gross. A national figure.
Yeah, I know. Seriously.
And again, this is the Times not grasping that in the modern age, probably the Yang Gang hashtag has more media reach than the New York Times does at this point.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, the condescension is just incredible.
Disgusting, yeah.
I don't know. To what do you to attribute the fascination with the Klobuchar thing? Like, I
think that the people who really don't want it to be Bernie are just desperate, and they're hoping that, like, if they throw a bunch of stuff at the what's the expression?
The spaghetti at the wall.
Yeah, throw spaghetti at the wall and see what sticks. It's like, okay, we're going to take a centrist. We're going to take someone who kind of, like, pretends to be progressive and is kind of progressive. This woman's been elected a lot of times. She had a Midwestern thing going about her. Like, I just think that they're trying to find the anti-Sanders. I was a little surprised. Why didn't they go for Pete? He just doesn't have the viability because of his polling with...
Yeah, their take on Pete was basically, you know, nice first shot. We hope he stays in the game, and maybe someday down the line, you know, the implication is maybe in the future we'll take him more seriously.
Yeah.
But it's just this institutional media response where they don't get that, you know, back in the day, 2004, 2008, the notion of getting an endorsement from this big establishment media organ would have carried this awesome weight with people, but it doesn't anymore, and it hasn't for a while.
Yeah.
But they don't know it. What they're expressing with this is that they don't know how they're perceived.
Right.
You know, and I think that was amazing.
Okay. Well, congrats.
What else we got?
Let's
see, the body language.
Oh my God.
Again. We don't want to do the...
We don't want to be...
I
mean,
this.
Okay, I probably do. I'm a stan. I'm a Bernie stan no matter what. But, like, I don't have to argue for a lot of Bernie coverage because it's just built into it, because we have to issue corrective behavior. We have to, you know, compensate.
Right.
He's under attack by basically every... Even if you don't like him... Now, I love him. You like him. I'm not pretending you dislike him. But, like, it's just fair game for media analysis because it's so relentless. So, here's Joanne Reed, friend of the show. We'd host her. Come on, Joanne.
We would, yeah, of course.
Friend of the show, who used to remember.
She wouldn't in a million years appear in the show.
I know. Well, you never know. Like, so let's watch Joanne Reed, who once was very rational and actually called Sanders like the clarion moral voice of the Democratic Party, before she started describing him as similar to your college roommate who doesn't pay rent and sleeps on your couch. So let's watch how Joanne Reed wanted to get to the bottom of this. He said, she said.
Dust up between the two of them is that scandals hurt you more when they seem plausible, right?
Right.
I mean, Bernie Sanders does have a sort of physicality, you know, when he talks, that is a shaking your finger at Hillary Clinton, shaking your finger, shovey, weirdy. His physicality makes me think, he could have said, you know, listen, I think in this environment a woman can't win. That doesn't seem like a crazy
thing. Well, first of all, I think Bernie's lying. We see him, he slouches forward anyway, Joy, but here he turtles. If you look at his eye level where he normally finally answer his question. When he makes the denial, his whole shoulders come up like a little kid getting caught. His eye level is below his shoulders. This is trying to hide in plain sight. And many of us, we don't know what to look for. So if you look for this right out of the gate, and the strongest denial is simply saying no. And I think women in particular, we want to believe human beings. So we're like, yeah, I would say that. He literally said, well, as a matter of fact, I didn't say it. That's 9 words. Unnecessary. No. Did you vote for Donald Trump in the last election?
Absolutely no.
Right? So no. Did you dress up as an Easter bunny on Easter?
Absolutely no.
Right? So it's no. We say no. Absolutely is actually not the strongest denial. You're playing with me here in the game, but at least you're getting the no in here. We're not hearing the no with Bernie. Also with Bernie, he has numerous hotspots. He says, well, liars like to start with, well, he looks away. He laughs. I think he might have been coached to laugh in this moment. A lot of politicians are coached to laugh in the difficult times. So we're focused on the laughter, and it's supposed to send a message that this isn't serious. It is serious. If he said it, which I believe that he did, he would have been better to just own it. You know, Barack Obama wrote a book years ago, and he said what in the book? He tried cocaine and marijuana, and he never touched the stuff again. We never talked about it when he was president after that. If Bernie just owned it, this would disappear. We wouldn't be talking about it 6 days
later. But Bernie, he did the opposite.
I want to say a couple things. First of all, do we have a quote from Joanne Reed where she denied something? Because I want to see how well Joanne Reed's statement measures up to the criteria. Do you remember when she was accused of tweeting homophobic things, and then actually she said she hadn't, and then they were found, and she said that they were like, she was hacked by Russians?
Of course.
So here's what she said. She didn't say, no, I didn't do that. She said, now that the site has been compromised, I can state unequivocally that it does not represent the original entries. I hope that whoever corrupted the site recognizes the pain they've caused, not just to me, but to my family and communities that I care deeply about, LGBTQ, immigrants, people of color, and other marginalized groups. Why so many words?
That's a lot of words.
That's a lot of words.
That's like 37 words. Yeah. I don't know how many words that
Why
is.
Why didn't
that's
she just say, no, I was hacked?
Yeah. I mean, it's ridiculous. There's two things about that. Number one, in the debate,
he did say no. First
yeah,
of all.
Abby Phillip at the end, she says, "Just to be clear, you didn't say it." And he's like, "No,
no,
right? Yeah." No. The other thing is that's hilarious about this scene is that this Janine Driver, this body language expert, Joy completely screws up what's happening.
I know.
She asks her,
she absolutely does, Matt.
Yeah, yeah. She gets her to say, "Did you vote for Donald Trump?" And Reed says, "Absolutely no," or "No, absolutely,"
yeah,
right?
Absolutely no.
And then she does it again because she wants her to just say no.
Yeah, exactly. And she's like, "All right, you're playing with me."
Yeah,
all right.
Yeah, exactly. That's just really,
it's
really
so
funny.
Stupid. Also, let's look at her body language. Why is she reaching forward like she's about to tip over and lunge at Joy? And also, let's talk about the anti-Semitic adjacent discourse here. First, there's a lack of coherence. He has a physicality, so we could see him lying? No. You're basically saying you don't like him and you don't like his physicality, which, by the way, it's kind of Jewy. Like, he's very Jewy in his physicality. This is a thing. We do this, especially men. And he doesn't just... I know that for Joanne Reed and all these pseudo...
Rabbinical
people,
is the word they often
rabbinical.
Use. Yeah.
Yeah. For all these people who pretend to have politics that extend beyond their own, like, personal lives, they pretend that it's about anything besides, like, microaggressions or symbolism. But Joanne Reed can't even keep it under the... Like, she can't even hide how much this is about her own weird identification with Hillary Clinton.
Weirdy.
Yeah. She's a weirdy. I'm going to call her a weirdy. And
well,
why?
She used it as an adjective. Weirdy.
Didn't she do that with like Russia-y and Kremlin-y? She really likes doing that. But why is she talking about Hillary Clinton? Like, again, because this is all a weird thing about 2016. But what does the fact that he uses his hands, why does that mean he's a liar? It's like such a weird...
Well,
she's
look,
basically saying I think he's a misogynist, so I could see him saying that.
Let's just put our cards on the table about this.
I believe Joanne Reed. Just kidding.
Body language analysis is crap science.
Oh, yeah.
Everybody knows it's crap science.
Yeah.
It's totally meaningless. Even the people who invented this...
She sounds
this,
so smart. Yeah.
I forget what it's called. Kinesiology, kinesics, or something like that. I forget what it is. It's the people who invented this discipline... admit that there are no core principles to it. It's
right.
It's wholly interpretive, which just means it's perfect for modern journalism. It's just thing you put somebody on television and then you just bullshit about stuff.
You just
say, oh, this looks like that, and then so it's just a way to talk about how to lend weight to something that you want to say anyway without actually having any insight. And we should point out that the non-Bernie aspect of this is that this technique has a long and ugly history already on cable news. Bill O'Reilly was famous for it. And it also came up, it's come up a lot in the last 3 years with people who testify in Congress. Yeah. It's come up in the Russia story a few times. They do it constantly with Trump. And like the joke there is, like, you don't need body language analysis to know what's going on with Trump most of the time. He tells you, you know. Yeah. But
do you think, though, she pitched it to MSNBC? She's like, look, before you say no, just think about it. Really outside the box idea. Body language analyst.
I don't know how it works over there with their producers, whether they have to go upstairs with ideas or not. I mean, look, it's
or
only
just
one
have,
show.
Like, it's Bernie, so do whatever you want.
The last thing I think it's important to say about this is that when you do campaign reporting, there's an enormous temptation to try to read into stuff like that because you just got to fill so much time and space. So you say, oh, you know, on the stump, this person looks like they don't mean it when they say this, or they look really excited when they talk about healthcare, but they don't look excited when they talk about something else. So, but you can't do that. It's like, it's one of those laws of the campaign is, like, every time you catch yourself doing that, you got to pull back and stop.
Right.
You can't read into things because you just don't know. And for them to go a step further than this and get an expert in it.
Right. Not just doing it in-house.
They're formalizing it.
Right, it's not just like a shooting off the hip thing they notice. They're actually reifying it as a science.
Right, yeah, exactly.
It reminds me, when she's like, you're playing with me, it reminds me of in Waiting for Guffman, Ron and Sheila, Fred Willard's character, he does this thing where he's like, oh, stop it, to Corky Sinclair when they're doing interpretive dance.
Oh, right, yeah.
Okay, so this is kind of a combo of Stone moments and dance moments.
Okay.
To just lend themselves. So here, let's get started at the top. The Democratic candidates were in South Carolina on Monday for MLK Day, and there's this a bunch of footage, like some kind of viral images of Sanders and Steyer. They have a real interesting
bromance.
Yeah, and so people are trying to guess what was being said there. Looks like he's like trying to bother Sanders for like an autograph or something, and Sanders is like, all right, enough already. Of course, Steyer was there when Sanders and Warren, when Warren wouldn't shake his hand. You remember Steyer was there, and he's like, I don't want to get involved, but I just want to say hi, Bernie. Like, he seems like a real Bernie fan. But this, then it gets really good. I don't know how to describe this dancing, but
that.
How would you describe it? Okay, so they're on stage, and Sanders is like clapping his hands. Steyer is doing this like rocking body movement, rocking, and then he does.
Whoa,
this,
that's like, that
fist,
is bad.
A what fist is thing? He does like a fist going round and round, like the whoop. Who was that? Arsenio
Hall.
The whoop thing.
Yeah.
And there's a woman, but Sanders is looking pretty good. So that one's pretty good. But then let's look. There's another one that's even better. Like,
oh yeah, I like the pelvic thrust.
Yeah, the pelvic thrust. The hand in the pocket, but now he's really rocking it.
That is
now
fantastic.
Now he's doing like a. How would you describe that?
I don't know, but it's...
He's like a fist pound up in the air, and he...
it's very Deuce Bigelow.
Yeah, it's kind of great, though.
Yeah, exactly. Just don't dance in that situation.
Yeah. Well,
although,
kind of
I guess,
endearing.
What do you do?
I know.
You think? I don't know.
Yeah, I think it's endearing. I kind of like him. And then...
I can't dance, so, I mean,
okay,
I just won't. Yeah, it does, totally.
So in terms of dancing, there are some other dancing clips making the rounds, or rhythm clips. So
Andrew Yang was in Waterloo,
and he's at a church. It looks like he's at a black church, and he's wearing the robes.
The coral robes.
So it's kind of interesting, if you, like, pan. It's an interesting pan that happens, and you see some people singing, and then it goes over, and you see, lo and behold, Andrew Yang is there. And he's clapping on the beat, on the 2 and 4, I believe.
Jesus said, if you lean on me.
There you go.
Good, right? It's good rhythm.
That's impressive.
He's good, right?
He's on time.
Yeah, he's on time. He's in rhythm. And then we have
By the way, Andrew Yang has a lot of physicality to his stump performance.
Yeah.
He runs onto the stage and everything. Like he brings a lot of energy to his campaigning, which is interesting.
Yeah.
So that's very much in his favor.
That's very much. Yeah. And then we don't want to be called sexist. So let's see. Should we watch Warren in Brooklyn? This is a couple seconds. This is great. Okay, this is like she's. I feel so bad. She's so uncomfortable on stage, and like it was just a rally that happened right after Soleimani died, I think. R.I.P. And she's like, I've been in this situation. You don't really. you're almost making it into a joke, like, ha ha ha, I'm gonna do these really funny over the top dance moves. So she does like a hula dance move and like her
Yeah, you're trapped in like this irony chasm.
Yeah, exactly.
Right? And you don't, there's no way out. Like you either have to like go full fledged and dance or just don't do it. But then when you're in the middle, you're just a dead duck.
Yeah. Dead duck. Speaking of Amy Klobuchar. And then the last thing really quickly is let's just watch Warren at Pride because she really wilds out here. She looks like she looks like she's a runner. She's running. Look at her, the high fives. She's walking around. Look at that, her and Melissa Etheridge. She just looks like she's a runner. She looks like a runner wearing a rainbow boa. And by the way, she is wearing a rainbow boa and she's running and hugging people and it's kind of related. It's her.
Right?
Oh, it's the Liz Holio. Oh wait, what was that? Hold on, can we just see that again? This one's great. She's doing like a We're Not Worthy almost.
Yeah, no,
she's like bending forward.
It's a Liz Holio into a We're Not Worthy.
Look, she's Liz Holioing again. But then she's like bending. Yeah. So Liz Holio is basically when your hands are up in the air and your elbows are
Liz Holio.
Yeah, and your elbows are bent.
Yeah. Yeah, that's
like
the,
that.
That's the Beavis Pit pose.
Yeah.
I feel like I should just say that if either of us had to run for president, it would be infinitely more embarrassing.
No, it wouldn't be. You've never seen me dance.
That's true. I haven't seen you dance.
I mean, running is not a good look.
I would be embarrassing running for president. Yeah. It would be terrible. So.
I think I can dance better than war. Okay, maybe I'm at like Yang level.
You think you're at Yang level?
Yeah. But
are you in time?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. Excellent. Yeah. All right. So that was great.
That was
Let's talk to Denis Kucinich, who ran for president in 2004-2008, whose views are now becoming mainstream and is a really interesting figure who has a lot of insight into this race.
Yeah. By the way, we tried very hard to do video with Congressman Kucinich. It didn't work out.
And we should thank him for his patience.
Of
we
course,
went through
yeah.
it like eight different times trying to make it work. Didn't work.
It was
and
a great
we apologize.
Well, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thanks to both of you for the invitation to be on this podcast. I really appreciate it.
Oh, of course. Yeah.
No, thank you. Just for folks who don't know your story all that well, you had a tough childhood. You lived in a car when you were younger. You lived in an orphanage, I think, at one point. It's an uncommon background for a modern politician. Can you talk a little bit about how that experience informed your future political views and how it helped you decide to run for city council at such a young age?
Well, you know, the experience that I had growing up in Cleveland, Ohio is probably an experience that's been shared by many Americans who have fallen through the cracks in the economy. But for me, that experience of living in 21 different places by the time I was 17, including a couple cars, of spending a few months in an orphanage after my mom had a nervous breakdown on the birth of her sixth child. I'm the oldest of seven, and that the experience is indelibly impressed on my awareness. I mean, I understand how difficult it is for people who are trying to make ends meet. I also understand people who are reaching up and trying to aspire to do better in life. And because I've seen the journey, I've experienced the journey, but I also know a lot of people I grew up with, including siblings, didn't have the same breaks that I had in life. And I decided a long time ago before I got into public life that if I ever got anywhere in life, I would make it a point to not just remember where I came from, but to try to do something about the conditions that I experienced growing up, which are being experienced today by so many people.
You mentioned your mother had a nervous breakdown, as you said, after her
postpartum
nervous breakdown, postpartum depression.
Right.
How was she treated? Like, was there a support system for that? Was there medical care that was she covered?
She was able to get medical care, and you know, my dad as a Teamster had access to a fairly decent health plan at that point. But there was nowhere for the children to go other than to leave the newborn with some relatives. And the rest of us went to what was then known as Parmadale in Cleveland. It's a Catholic orphanage. And it was, although it was a period we were there for probably about 3 months over the holidays, it was tough. And it was tough thinking that you're not going to see your parents again. And for my mom, it took her quite a while to recover. It probably took her a year to recover. And we moved out to a farm for a while in Michigan from Ohio. And during that time, she was able to get her smile back and get her sense of vitality back. But let's face it, for any woman who's ever given birth to 10, as she did, with three not quite making it to birth, and raising seven children, it was a tremendous strain on her. And she was well educated. She taught me to read by the time I was 3 years old.
Oh wow!
And that was probably the single most important factor in my growing up, that I could read so early. And my mom did that.
And how old were you when this happened? When you lived, you went to live in the.
I think it's 12 or 13.
12 or 13, you said. Okay, so that's like a very formative age, right?
We were living in Parmadale when I was about 11 years old.
11, yeah.
But when we were, and we were living in a car before that, the tremendous stress that a family had then, and today in some families experience it, where you aren't sure where you're going to live. I mean, even though my dad worked pretty steadily, the size of the family was such, and the expenses of a large family was such, that he was never able to make ends meet. And not only that, but you also had the insults which happen in the inner city, where people are buying television sets that don't work, cars that break down. There's all the scam artists that are out there beating people up. We experienced that, and that, of course, gave me a great sympathy for consumer matters. Whether the people of Cleveland know it or not, actually led to my efforts to form help form Cleveland's Department of Consumer Affairs back in 1972.
Wow. Because so, you saw people getting ripped off?
Absolutely. I mean, you know, wherever you turn. the life in the inner city, it's not just what David Kaplowitz wrote about saying, poor pay more. And it's a current problem as well. But it's also, you know, people selling life insurance policies on the children. And, you know, it's everywhere you turn, there's some kind of a scam going on. And, you know, of course, it made me rather street smart, and I took those street smarts into government.
Well, okay, so let's get to that. So you're 19, 20 years old. You decide to run for the city council.
Right.
Where did that idea come from? And then you don't have any money. Did you actually have an expectation that you were going to get elected? And what was the plan? And how did you manage to do it? You did it, actually, by the time you were 22, 23, if I'm not mistaken.
Well, I was working at the night desk at the Plain Dealer answering phones, and some guy called in from a bar, said they had a candidate who was going to run for council, and I had no idea about city council. I actually was interested in my mid-teens to being a congressperson. I even wrote it in an autobiography that I wrote, I think, in the 10th grade. I wanted to be in national politics. But when I heard about this rattling going on from a bar, I just turned to an assistant city editor and I said, what do you have to do to be a councilman? He says, well, you have to file petitions. And then the next thing he smiled and he said, why, are you interested? And I thought, hey, yeah, I am. It was in the neighborhood I lived in. And so that one thing led to another. I took out petitions. I started knocking on doors. One disadvantage I had is while I may have been 20, I looked like I was 12. And the first door I knocked on, a woman looked at me, walked away for a second. I waited nonplussed, and she came forward, opened the screen door, and passed some coins in my hands and said, I thought I already paid you for the paper.
Oh, my God, that's really funny.
And, it, you know, it was just a problem with credibility. People had no idea that of my age and when I ran the closest race that anybody had run to this incumbent, then people started to pay attention.
And so that you go on, you make the city council in your early 20s. I think you're mayor by the time you're 30 or 31.
31, yeah.
Yeah, so were you the... Where does that fit in the history of youngest elected politicians in the country? Was either of those things...
The headline in the Cleveland Plain Dealer, the subhead said, youngest big city mayor wins by 3,000 votes. And that was in the Plain Dealer on Wednesday. I think it was November 9th, 1977. So, yeah, I started very early, 10 years after I started in politics, I was elected mayor.
Wow.
And immediately you had very high profile clashes with some of the industrial and financial powers in the city. You clashed with the light utility over the baseball stadium, if I'm not mistaken, right? And then there was another...
Mm-hmm. Well, let me, if I may... Mm-hmm. I was elected mayor of Cleveland on a promise to save the city's municipal electric system from a takeover by a utility monopoly. For all intents and purposes, the system was sold. I blocked it with a petition drive, which led to me becoming a candidate for mayor. And this was a defining issue in the mayor's race in 1977. And I was elected on the promise to save the electric system, which provided the people of Cleveland with cheaper electricity and savings on street lights and providing electricity to dozens of city facilities. But what happened, while my first act in office was to declare that the sale of Muni Light was dead and that Muni Light was in fact assured of being in public control, at that very moment, the utility that I was contesting with and their bank partners laid a trap, which led to December 15th, 1978, me being told either I sell that electric system to the its competitor, private utility monopoly, or the banks would not renew the city's credit on loans I hadn't even taken out on $14.5 million in loans. So that was a pivotal moment in my life, not just my career, where I had to decide what I stood for. Did I stand for the people's right to own a utility they could call their own? Did I stand for their right to be able to save money on an electric bill? What did I stand for? Did I stand for the autonomy of city government to be able to make decisions without the pressure from interest groups? And so I refused to sell. And the biggest bank in Ohio, which was also a major shareholder in the utility, the private utility, refused to renew the city's credit. Unprecedented, Cleveland went into default, first city to go into any fiscal default since the Great Depression. And, the pressure on me was enormous. The media was part of it. They were all aligned with the utility. The social reality and political reality of Cleveland had been reconstructed to assume I had no other alternative but to sell, but I said no. And that cost me the mayor's office, but, 15 years later, I made a comeback.
I think you also told me a story once about using eminent domain to block the sale of a hospital or the closing of a hospital.
Well, I had eminent domain is something that cities usually only use to help developers. And I was ready to use eminent domain to expand the city's electric system, to protect the public interest at any turn. The one thing, that I haven't said anything about that probably bears repeating right now is that 40 years ago, I started a book about this experience as mayor of Cleveland, taking on the banks and the utilities and the mob for that matter, because there were three assassination attempts. And I just finished the book recently. It's called, the working title is called The Division of Light and Power. It's about 618 pages of text with over 3,000 footnotes in addition to that. And it's really the story of one young person's clash with the powers that be in a community and the insistence that there is such a thing as a public interest, which every public official has an obligation to uphold. And it's a wild story. I just finished it, and I'm, you know, out there right now. I'll be looking for a publisher soon.
And can you talk about the assassination attempts?
Yeah, there was one attempt in January of 77 when I, you know, was starting up this fight to protect the electric system. A high-powered rifle shot through my house where, you know, where I'm calling from right now. And I had just got up out of my chair. The bullet missed my head by a fraction of an inch and went clear through the house. There was another one on Easter Sunday, 78, where police chased a guy away with a shotgun, and he basically in a tussle with police escaped. And then another one, which was a subject of a U.S. Senate Subcommittee on Organized Crime investigation, where I was supposed to be the grand marshal in a parade in the black community. And there was a mafia hit planned. And I would have been in that parade, except that when I was getting ready to go to the parade, I had a bleeding ulcer that came out of nowhere. And I was rushed to the hospital and transfused eventually with about 6 units of blood. And I almost died from that, but it saved my life because I wasn't in the parade. So, you know, I've had my share of ups and downs and of conflicts in public life. But the one thing that I have always felt is that it's critical just stay true to who you are and true to who you represent, and don't feel that you have to give in, no matter which powers are arrayed against you. You just, you know, you have to stand for something, and that's basically the approach I take in life.
So that experience of running for office at a very young age, succeeding without a whole lot of institutional backing, you take on a lot of financial and industrial powers in office. You kind of repeat that whole plot later on at the federal level when you decide in the early 2000s to run for president. Can you talk a little bit about what your thinking was in 2004? Prior to that election, because it was a bit of a similar situation, right?
I'll tell you what happened. You know, in you have to go back to the Clinton administration's attack on Serbia. They decided to bomb Serbia at a time that the people there were really interested in the overthrow of Milosevic, I saw in the Democratic caucus normally calm, placid people rally to a bombing, and that led me to become involved sub rosa in an event, in a effort that surfaced that blocked Clinton's congressional approval for the war. But that got me thinking about war and about how wars start and how governments approve of them and how people get swept up in it. And so after 9/11, I saw the country swept up in this war fury again. And I started to dissect what was going on, whether the call for war was legitimate or not. And I actually have posted on the internet, if somebody typed in October 2nd, 2002, Kucinich analysis of Iraq war resolution, where I knew then that there was no legitimate reason to go to war against Iraq. And I laid it out. And then I saw what was happening, notwithstanding that, how we went to war and innocent people were dying. American troops were dying. A country was being wrecked. Our country, our aspirations at home were being destroyed. And so when I saw that, I said, you know, unless someone else comes forward, I'm going to run. As improbable as my candidacy was, and may still seem in retrospect to some, I determined that if no one else was going to make the war an issue, I would. And so that led me on an extraordinary journey across the country, meeting people and seeing how the American people, by and large, have a lot in common. And what they have in common is they want decent lives for their families. They want to make sure that they're safe. They're not interested in sending troops around the world to kill other people. That campaign proved to me that there's an underlying unity in America. But our politics are so divisive and so pecuniary in nature that it's very tough to connect with the American people on their level of aspirations.
That connection you talk about, that unity on that issue and some others, you know, including like, you know, working class politics, I've noticed in sort of recent media treatments of your career that oftentimes, for instance, the Washington Post talked about how your politics represent the sweet spot between where Sandersism meets Trumpism. They talked about your nearly Trumpian parables of good and evil. Is there an issue now where any politician who tries to build a bridge between left and right gets that comparison? In other words, you're appealing to Trump people. There's an issue there. There's a problem there.
You have to look at the mindset in the world today, you know, which of course affects our politics. We have a tremendous amount of polarization and compartmentalized thinking. And people have trouble holding complexities. They have trouble with seemingly mutually contradictory premises existing simultaneously. And so, the idea that one can unify left and right seems quite impossible to some. But I would argue that even what we try to describe as left and right is fundamentally flawed. That not just with respect to the definitions, but that to me there's nothing left or right about healthcare, about education, about jobs, and the attempt to try to turn it into polarities is to me an effort to avoid debate and not to encourage it. There's not always two sides to every question. There's not two sides to whether you assassinate a foreign leader or not. You know, there are certain principles that need to guide a country that that are beyond notional and go to verities of what life is about, what's a country about, what the practical aspirations of people are concerned about. And so, you know, left, right, to me, doesn't do it. Labels don't do it. They don't describe people's challenges and their ability to be able to make it day to day. So I reject the foundational aspects of present day partisan politics, and say that it doesn't serve anybody except a narrow elite, and often disserves the people of this country by not truly offering any kind of a choice or even a solid a position from which one can come to a fair conclusion about whether one approves or disapproves of what someone's offering. It's all smoke and mirrors and deception, and I'm not interested in that. To me, you know, if I ran into a guy in Cleveland who was standing on a corner and he rolled up his sleeve and his arm was filled with watches, I knew those watches were phony. And I know the political party is selling phony solutions and offering phony proposals to the people of this country.
So just getting back to 2004, you run for president on a platform that people thought at the time was crazy. They laughed at it, but it's become mainstream. You were opposed to NAFTA, you were for gay marriage, you were for marijuana legalization, you were against the Iraq war, universal health care, all these things are, they're no longer, nobody laughs at those issues anymore. What role do you think the media had in convincing people to not take these things seriously? I remember covering that campaign. It was very frustrating. I wondered what your experience was with that and how hard it was for you to try to get that message out.
Well, one not be naive, you know, one need not be naive about the role of the media in our society. When it comes to war, media is essentially steer carriers. And today, you know, media war is clickbait. And we have to understand that conglomeration, the media, has affected the politics of the country. And there's no, you know, media generally is going to have sensibilities that align with the corporate interests of the owners. Like A.J. Leibling said years ago, freedom of the press belongs to the person who owns one. So I think we have to we have to be realistic. The media beat the drums for the war in 2002, 2003. The media permitted George Bush to be able to conflate Iraq and 9/11. The media gave great amounts of coverage to those who were for the war and very little coverage to those who were opposed to it. And what's interesting, even to this day, those who opposed the war and those of us who were very vocal about it are seldom asked for our opinion about any other foreign policy. Well, those who were, you know, repeatedly wrong, not just about Iraq, but about Libya and a number of other conflicts and wrong about Iran, they're continually asked for their opinion, and their opinions are arrogated to some type of ceremony of a religion or something. You know, we really have a problem, and the airwaves are saturated with the opinions of those who are interested in war, and in some cases have a financial stake in a war.
I remember back then, one of the things that you were well known for was you had proposed a Department of Peace, and I remember the reaction of the press to that idea. Has anyone ever given you a good reason why that isn't a good idea? I mean, that was
right. It seems too much. In 1972, I proposed free transit in Cleveland, and the opposition to it said, well, if you have that, everybody's going to want to ride the bus.
Oh, that's terrible. That's awful.
You know, when I proposed the Department of Peace, the idea of it is, because it's an active consideration, is that that we can teach peace. If violence is a learned response from all the stimuli that any of us get in our environment, then you can also learn peace. And so the idea is you start teaching peace giving, peace sharing, mutuality, looking at the other person as an aspect of oneself. And you start doing that at a very early age. And so you build peace into the culture of the country, and as opposed to war, which is so deeply ingrained, and the violence that comes with it. So the Department of Peace, the idea was that you'd have a domestic component, and which would deal with domestic violence, spousal abuse, child abuse, violence in the school, gang violence, gun violence, racial violence, violence against gays, police community relations, clashes, police community clashes. And then on an international level, you use diplomacy as you start to see problems percolating. So you do everything you can to avert conflict, and you train people how to do that. I take the budget as being 1% of the current, whatever the current Pentagon budget would be. Then it was about $4 billion a year. But we need to create a structure in our society to give people some other options that they don't feel like the only way that they can deal with their problems is through lashing out, is through killing other people. And the thing that I think it's critical to bring home is this. all this violence that the United States wreaks around the world, all these wars and undeclared wars and the various ways of our government and, you know, and working through hundreds of bases in 70 different countries. Is there anyone out there that doesn't understand that violence that we sow abroad comes back home? The world is interconnected. It's interdependent. There is no way to avoid when you kill people abroad, that doesn't come back. What you do is you create a consciousness of violence, and that consciousness achieves a certain velocity with the media and with movies and everything else. And before you know it, life doesn't seem to have as much value. And it's a problem which exists today.
This week was Martin Luther King Day, and I mean, he's someone who really talked about that, the intersection of different types of violence and, you know, the violence here in the United States and then the violence of the war in Vietnam. But so many of the people who claim to tout his ideas or respect him are the same people who would mock something like what you're talking about.
Look, I'm talking from Cleveland right now. There's a tremendous amount of violence that's happening on the streets of the city. How does it get that way? How does a society get that way? We're not looking at those things. It's almost as if people believe you can't do anything about it. So I believe you can do something about it. I believe that we're not here to live in a world where people believe that life is a funeral march to the grave. Life is to be celebrated. Life is to be treasured and cherished. And we need to do everything we can to protect the instinct towards. It's what the poet called the instinct within us that reaches and towers. And we have to protect our ability to reach up to build a better world than maybe is a world even beyond our imagination. And violence cuts that short.
In that vein, again, a lot of the ideas that you ran on in 2004 and 2008, looking back, people say, "Oh, that's obvious." But, you know, universal health care, what a great idea. Legalization of marijuana. I feel like one of the things that people are eventually going to realize is obvious is your attitude towards the mixture of politics and funding from weapons contractors. I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but you don't feel that you can really pursue any kind of progressive agenda if you're being funded by people who make money off war. And that seems like, it seems obvious now, but it's not yet in the mainstream.
We have to be aware of the extent to which war is built into our system. Every congressional district has defense contractors who lobby members of Congress when the budget authorizations and appropriations are up. And so there's a constituency to keep the spending going and to keep the use of those war material ever present. And it's so distorted our priorities. Joseph Stiglitz and Linda Vilmos wrote the book about the $3 trillion war, which is probably more looking like five, if not six, the result of Afghanistan and Iraq. People make money off of war. I mean, it's as General Smedley Butler once said, it's a racket. And when you understand that it's a racket, you understand how people's lives are put on the line for it. It's horrific. And you don't need to be the aging pop star Boy George to say war is stupid. It has no real purpose in a world which is technologically advanced, is interconnected and interdependent, where I can speak to you across 600 miles on a cell phone, or I can call the other side of the world, send a text message in a matter of seconds to anybody anywhere in the world. What are we talking about here? Why are we still in, you know, looking for war when we ought to be looking for peace? Why are we looking for opportunities to stir things up as a nation? You know, why do we even have people in our government who can influence a president to assassinate a leader as they did at the beginning of the year when Iranian General Soleimani was murdered? You know, we have to demand peace. We cannot accept anymore our government spending the treasure of our nation, distorting our national priorities. We're losing the chance for the lives that all of us want in these wars. And you know, I'm sick of people using the flag. I'm sick of people using a distorted version of patriotism. I say it's patriotic to have education for all, free college for all, health care for all, decent wages for every American. That's patriotic. It's patriotic to have clean environment. It's patriotic to have safe streets. We need to rework that idea of patriotism and tear it away from the idea that you can only be patriotic when you stand and beat the drums for war. We absolutely have to change America's role in the world. I say close the bases abroad, bring America home. We don't need to be spending the billions of dollars that we do having a position of oversight of the world through our military. There's America needs a fundamental and structural change in its governance and in its economy for this country to be able to prosper.
It's funny how people will call you naive or call people with the view that you're expressing naive, but they don't believe or acknowledge how much having like lobbyists influences the decisions to go to war. Like they're actually incredibly naive. People who think that we go to war for reasons that are like moral or politically pure. And I had two other questions. One is if you think that the attempt to kind of equate left and right is a cynical, like people will say that Trump and Bernie are similar in a way that I actually think that they're just making the case that Bernie is electable against Trump because they're saying that he appeals to some of the same people Trump does. And I haven't really seen that before. I think it's a really weird argument.
They also say the same thing about Tulsi a little bit.
Yeah, sure. Tulsi and Trump. Yeah. Like the idea that because you as a politician can speak to a certain population that we would like to win, that makes you somehow Trumpian as opposed to competitive against them.
It's an important question because it really is what frames our politics today. You can simultaneously argue, well, there are people who align on the left and there are people who align on the political right. We got that. The concern is, do they have any underlying mutuality of interests? And I say, yes, there are. But you have to take time to develop them. And why is there such an emphasis on left and right? It's marketing. You know, there's people to whom political resources are allocated based on their insistence that they stand with the left or they stand with the right. There's fundraising that goes on along those lines. But the real world exists not as a pure liberal or pure conservative. There's elements of each that thread their way through all of our lives. And it's the polarization that's the problem. It's the belief that unless you buy the kit and caboodle of a political ideology, you somehow aren't a righteous person. And this is all crazy. The country's being sharply divided over ideas that really aren't very well thought out. I mean, if you would get underneath this all, maybe it's the fact that outside of predatory capitalism, America really doesn't have a cogent political philosophy.
It seems like it's also a way to delegitimize things like anti-war sentiment, right, or the embrace of universal programs, if you pretend that those things are Trumpian and Sandersian or Trumpian and Gabbardian, then they're extremist things, even though we know that they actually have mass support. So it's a way to undermine actual universal programs or peace. I mean, not to be too dramatic about it.
That's true.
And on that note of universal programs, I just want to ask, we've heard some candidates like Klobuchar and Mayor Pete make the argument that universal programs are unfair because the wealthy will take advantage of them and we shouldn't ask poor people to be paying for those. And as someone who, you know, experienced the hardships that you did as a young person, especially, what is your response to that?
Well, look, let's get real here. I don't think there should be means testing for any federal program. There shouldn't be means testing for Social Security. We should take the caps off for sure. As to how much income is available to be taxed, but there shouldn't be mean testing for education. Everyone should be able to share in the bounty of the country,
and
the fact that others want to means test is just a way of dividing people and having people who have great influence say, well, you know, if I'm not going to get anything, no one should.
Right. It's so disingenuous because it's such a way they're pretending that they're doing it to protect poor people and working class people from having to take on pay for the, you know, people like Barron Trump, who's going to go to a public.
Yeah, it's going to be inherently unfair.
Yeah, inherently unfair. Yeah. But I mean, one of the reasons that universal programs are so important and means tested programs can be so dangerous is because of the stigma that goes along with them. And did you experience that when you were growing up? Like, was there a sense that you were getting special treatment or you were dependent on handouts and in a way that you wouldn't have felt had more programs been?
It wasn't, let me tell you, if it wasn't for the nuns at the various schools I went to, you know, there are times our family wouldn't have even had decent clothes on our back. I mean, I remember one year I wore one pair of pants for most of the year. They were turquoise blue with black piping. It looked probably like something out of a psychedelic prison. And it was the only pair of pants I had until one day a neighborhood dog went after me and ripped them. And then I had to wear ripped pants to school until a teacher saw it and said, hey, what's going on? And that led to her giving clothes to our family. You know, the idea of a handout, it's about a hand up. It's not about a handout. I mean, everybody should have a chance in our society to make it. And for those who are less fortunate with a little bit of help, they can become more fortunate. We divide people. We divide people and say, well, haves and have nots. No, we're all, if we're truly one nation, then we should be looking at ourselves as one, not just haves and have nots. We need to have a more fair distribution of opportunities. The tax system is one way that can help make that happen. Ending war can help make that happen. Changing our monetary policy so that you don't have money being created out of nothing and given to the banks and who are foreclosing homes of people who they sold low-doc loans. We have a country that is increasingly divided on class lines, sometimes on race, on economic lines. And while you can't, there's always going to be some of that, we can never let it be institutionalized. And these programs like healthcare for all and Social Security and education for all are ways of protecting what is essentially American. That is that we have some underlying unity of cause and purpose in our nation.
Congressman, I know we'll
so
let
great.
You go in a moment. Just really quickly, we're about to head into Iowa, New Hampshire. This has been an unprecedented, crazy campaign season. What's your diagnosis of what's going on with the Democratic Party? They had 29 candidates run this year. It almost seems like the party bureaucracy is trying to prevent at all costs moving in the direction that you suggested so many years ago. What do you think? How do you think this is going to shake out? And what do you think they're thinking in terms of their strategy going forward?
Well, look, you have two parties, but they're actually one party of a corporate behemoth in America. And what we need to do is to really consider whether or not the two-party system is, serves this country, whether or not it's time to decouple presidency from the two-party system, which rules Congress. There's a fundamental flaw in a system which lets corporations dictate the choices that people have at the end. And with Buckley versus Valeo and Citizens United, that's kind of where we're at. You know, one thing about the Sanders campaign is he's been raising a lot of money independent of those interests. That's, I think, why the party will continue to try to frustrate his efforts. The same with Tulsi Gabbard on another level. Look, political... Let me just add this. It's never made sense that there's only two ways of looking at the world, and this, you know, a Democrat way and a Republican way. It's just it's past confounding. It's a demonstrable lie that does violence to the idea of an America. Out of many, we are one. We're ignoring the diversity of opinions in this country, and in some ways, that's what political parties seem to be set up to do.
We've had terrible wildfires in Australia this year. I know this is an issue that's near and dear to your heart, climate change. You proposed ages ago a Works Green administration. What needs to be done, and is this the biggest issue for you this year going forward?
Well, it's interrelated with war, because war is ecocide. War destroys, you want to talk about things that will raise atmospheric carbon levels. You know, war is nothing but an exchange of destructive levels of carbon propelled by carbon, and propelled, I might add, by fossilized thinking. So you have to ask yourself, what can we do to start to bring down levels of atmospheric carbon so we can ameliorate some of the changes that are happening? We're not going to reverse them, but we can slow them down. I think, you know, one of the things is taking a regenerative approach towards agriculture, looking at carbon sequestration, how to accelerate it using certain growing methods, changing fuels that are used. Perhaps green jet fuel will be a direction that some of the airlines will go in, that some of them are looking at it right now, and some are even experimenting with it, using alcohol instead of oil for fuel. The waste to alcohol, using waste to create fuel, and that would supplant oil. And what's happening is there is a growing awareness on the part of corporations that they need to take a different direction. Oil companies know this. They only spent perhaps 1% of their revenue in looking towards the greening of their industry last year, but they understand that it's not sustainable, the track that they're on. Investment companies are aware of it. Some big investment banks in Europe, as well as even a firm such as BlackRock, is now looking at investments in protecting and restoring the climate. So I think we're seeing a shift come about, but it's not happening fast enough. And the undercurrent of our politics, which is so wrapped up in war for oil, is keeping us locked into this, for the next few years, certainly, and into policies which keep using fossil fuel, which use oil and gas, and that, you know, and fracking, which is so destructive of the environment and public health. So we can go in a new direction. We can have a Works Green administration, but you have to have an awareness in Washington of the urgency of taking that direction. And, you know, there are people who are aware, but certainly not enough. And this is where the country ought to be uniting now. This is where the country's efforts ought to be, not in trying to rattle the swords against Iran, but how can we unite the world community? You know, years ago, I was with Mikhail Gorbachev, at a summit in Johannesburg, South Africa, where we talked about a global green project. And, you know, we need to unite the world community instead of playing the game of nations, a geopolitical game that would put us on the precipice of war continually to control resources, mainly oil, that if we keep having fights over that, we'll stay addicted to carbon and addicted to war.
Last thing, Congressman, on the trail I saw you, I'd never saw anybody whose books were more marked up in the margins and who seemed to read as voraciously as you do, even during a political campaign. A lot of our listeners are very in despair right now about media choices, how they stay informed. Do you have any advice for people about what they can do to keep informed in an era when traditional media doesn't seem to address a lot of what people are concerned about?
You know, I look at media the way I walked into a cafeteria, although I have to confess I'm vegan, so my choices are a little bit different. But as I do that, I read everything I can get my hands on and watch anything that might relate to it. And it's my tastes are very eclectic. And so I find that, you know, I'm not interested in carrying anyone's intellectual water, but I'll read across the political spectrum, and I'll look at sometimes abstracts of university studies, or I'll also look at speeches, and you know, read my the website of the local papers, and then the national and international, talk to people around the world constantly, and you get a sense of what's going on. You know, it's not about being right or wrong. It's being informed to the best of your ability so you can be a good citizen. That's I think all of us owe that to each other and to our country.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dennis. Yeah. I really appreciate it.
Let me just say that I'm really grateful for the chance to do this.
Thanks so much, Dennis. Appreciate
Thanks.
It.
Have a great day.
Talk to you.
Take care.
Bye. Bye-bye.
You know, I learned something today.
What'd you learn? But this is, I love our idea. We're like, we have the idea to say what we've learned, but so far we're really good at the, like, I learned something today, but then we don't recap it.
We
so
don't really
we gotta,
recap.
We gotta have, like, what
well,
are
think,
our takeaways?
I think you learned that Dennis Kucinich is a very erudite
guy.
Right?
Yeah,
that surprised
I couldn't believe
you, right?
How, yeah, I mean, he's, like, way nerdier than I thought. He's very learned. And, hey, I would like to learn if you had ever witnessed this on the campaign
I have.
Trail.
Interesting that you should ask that, yeah. Katie. Yeah, no, so when I first covered Kucinich in 2004, I remember seeing him, I think it was at the University of New Hampshire, the first time I saw him, and he had given a speech, and after the speech, he runs off, and he reaches into a bag, and which is like full of books, like chock full of books, and he pulls out a book, and he goes and just sits down in a corner and starts reading to himself. And I see that his books are all marked up, which I would later see that he does all the time. Every book is written up in the margins. But this is a presidential candidate is off reading. So I go and ask him, like, is this for a speech? Like, are you picking out a passage or something?
Right.
No, he's just reading. It was just like somebody in between events was just educating himself, which is totally unusual for a presidential candidate. They're always talking to each other, you know. So
he's not calculating on that front, at least.
Not at all. He didn't care what people thought of him, you know. Yeah. He's just a super interesting guy. He's very intellectually courageous, I would say.
Yeah.
Like the thing that I always thought was distinguished him as a politician was that he looked at running for president the way of an intellectually serious person would. Like, what if you were actually trying to solve all these problems with the actual best solutions, what would you come up with? You know, as opposed to what I can get, what would actually work?
Yes,
you know,
but
as opposed to what would pass.
Right. He's not right. Because there's like he, you know, she has a plan for that. That's the whole technocracy like slogan.
Right.
He's not like that at all. He's very well read and very erudite, but he also has a very strong moral framework, which he owns. He is very well read, and he talks about how he reads abstracts of academic papers and stuff. And you heard him.
No,
yeah,
I mean, he reads philosophers he doesn't agree with. I always thought that was interesting.
Yeah, it's very important.
But, you know, like his idea about the Department of Peace, not to go on about this, but, you know, he looks at all these different issues, you know, mass shootings, domestic violence, crime on the streets, all these things. And the way he looks at it is these are all, it's all one problem, right? So if we could go in and we could teach people the, you know, as an affirmative value, how to, you know, non-violent conflict resolution, we could probably take care of a lot of these problems much more cheaply, easily, and we wouldn't go to war as much, all these things. Let's devote 1/100th of the Pentagon budget to fixing that, and let's see what happens. And they just, the degree to which he was laughed at for even bringing these things up was just crazy. But hopefully, eventually, the people will come around on some of this stuff.
My,
and they have.
My dad is like that. He takes a lot. Like, if we go away for the weekend, he'll have a suitcase full of books and a rolly thing. So, like, it gets really annoying. It'll, like, derail all the plans. Like, people think they're taking driving upstate for a weekend, and they don't anticipate how much room they have to have in the car and stuff.
What does he read?
Anything from, like, neurology books to crappy mysteries to, like, I don't know, philosophy books. But he does not write, and he would not respect the Kucinich method in this, because he does not believe in writing in books or folding books. He'll highlight and underline, like, medical textbooks.
That's a thing. Readers have different views on that. I like writing stuff in books.
Me too. I love that.
All right. Great show. So we'll see you again next week.
Yeah.